So my name is Guy Lawson. I'm a contributing editor of Rolling Stone magazine, and this is a story about how the Mexican cartels operate inside the United States. It's a follow-up to a couple of earlier stories that I did for the magazine. One was a piece that went to the Sierra Madres and looked at how the cartels function in their headquarters, what the culture of narcotic dealing is like. The second piece was about corruption in Mexico and the political class of Mexico City and how the cartels and the political culture are entwined, it would seem in a war, but also in this embrace, which is effectively turning Mexico into a narco state. And this third piece is looking at what impact it has in the United States. There's been a lot of hype about spillover violence, and I went to look at that. And what I found was very surprising to me. When I was assigned this piece, I think that my editor and I thought that I would find this violence, this incipient violence, becoming more of a phenomenon. And it really kind of flummoxed me for a while. You know, I'm a pretty experienced reporter. I've been around the block. I've covered, you know, foreign affairs and wars and things. And so I sort of had an idea what I would find. And I went to Alabama, you know, to be perfectly honest, because there was a quintuple homicide down there. And it looked like it was a cartel-level dispute. And in reporting and writing the piece, you know, I came to understand through the DEA guys down there, it wasn't a cartel-level multiple killing. It was a local pot dealer who'd been ripped off by some other local guys, who hired another thug to go over, get these guys, kill them, and then try to make it look like it was Mexicans. The tip-off was that they'd slit their throats, okay, after they were dead. In Mexico, they decapitate. They don't, you know, it's not a shaving cut that the Mexican cartel leaders have made a business decision not to bring their violence and disputation across the border. El Paso, for an example, is right across the river from Juarez. El Paso is the fourth safest city in the United States. Juarez is the most dangerous city maybe in the world, certainly in the hemisphere. Thousands of deaths, complete lawlessness. There's a Mexican saying, it's the same saying in English, of course, but it's like, don't kill the goose that lays the golden egg. They can fight and disagree about everything south of the border, but come north of the border, they have a very effective, sophisticated business model. The mythology of the Mexican narco is, or the narco in general, is this Tony Montana, you said, of the coke and the blood dripping down the nose, and somebody who is illiterate and violent and incapable of making informed or intelligent business decisions. The proof of the truth is how incredibly successful this distribution methodology is. There's $50 billion industry that's operating at near capacity, flourishing, making money in mountains. What you realize is that they're as sophisticated as Walmart and McDonald's and these postmodern multinational corporations that have learned to outsource, to franchise. I looked at Alabama, the state of Alabama, as an example, as a kind of a prototype for how the cartels are operating. How do they function? What's the cell structure look like? How do they behave? And you see the sophistication and the network and how it spreads out, how its fingers go out, and you have, for an example, the cocaine largely being dealt through African-American connections. They're more established. They can dice it down into coke. You have the meth distribution methodology more into the rural areas. A good way to think about the drug industry is as a corporation. You know, there's executives, vice presidents, managers. Then there's like the operational people. Then there's the truckers and the loaders and the dockers. It has all, it's vertically integrated. It has all these different aspects to it. So at the highest level, you have people who are operating at tens and hundreds of millions of dollars. But when they bring the drugs across the border, I mean, they're using all kinds of sophisticated methods to do that, submarines and tunnels and stuff. But once it's here, then it becomes a matter of distribution. So typically, you will have like a regional sales manager type of figure. I found a case in Alabama, northern Alabama, where there was this guy living a completely unexceptional life in a suburban existence, sort of lower class suburban existence with a lawn and modest home. And he was distributing 50 kilos of coke through a Brownsville, Texas link at the bottom level, which is to say the gangbanger standing on a corner in Baltimore or a hophead trying to move some meth outside of Piggly Wiggly in Birmingham. Typifying it's difficult, but suffice to say this. The idea that the Latino drug dealer is some Tony Montana-like person is not only wrong, it's dangerously wrong. It's deluded. It doesn't begin to understand the nature of the problem that confronts society, American and Mexican, and thereby doesn't begin to imagine solutions. There's no war on drugs going on inside the United States. There's a Mexican war on drugs, which is a violent, hot war, 13,000 dead and counting. And then there's this American war on drugs, which is largely political, rhetorical, and self-defeating. When you see hysterical coverage on CNN, when Anderson Cooper is standing at the Rio Grande saying, you know, here we are in the heart of the drugs war, you're not. You're not. It's a lot of it's hype. You should be looking at this more instrumentally. You should be looking at this from a point of view of logic and common sense instead of fear and hysteria.